morning. We are here to celebrate the life of Carl Fuller on behalf of his family, his wife, his children, and his grandchildren, and his extended family. We welcome you and we thank you for being here to remember him, to honor him, and to share our stories about him. Just a few housekeeping announcements before we begin the service. First of all, there are tissues in every single pew. There are small packs, which you can find them tucked in by the hymnals. And if you look and you don't see one, reach for the pew behind you. There should be some. Feel free to share them if you see that somebody needs them. There's a memory book that was out front. We hope if you did not already sign it, maybe add memory, that you will do so during the reception in the parish house out back. So the book will be out back for you to continue to sign if you did not already sign it. During the time of reflections that you will find in the bulletin, we have a few people that we know will be speaking, but we will create a moment of time. If you came with words to say about Carl, we will create a time for you to do so and invite you forward. So at that time, I will ask, is there anybody else that would like to share some words? And finally, at the end of the service, after the reflections are completed, we've given you two a chance to come forward and just maybe visit Carl for a moment yourselves. We will ask you to go back to your seats, and then we will ask the family to go first back into the parish house, and I'll ask that you remain seated while they do so, and then we will let you know when it's time to rise and go ahead and join them for the reception that follows this service. Please join me in prayer. Oh God, as we will hear in the psalm today, Psalm 121, you are the God of our going out and our coming in, and you ask to keep us and hold us every day of our lives. You surround us with your light and your goodness. You have known us from the time that we were first conceived and imagined. You knew us from the inside out, and you claimed us, and you claim us still. And we are grateful for our home here in this world, but we are grateful too that what you promise is a love that heals and makes us whole in a way that we cannot even imagine when we leave this home and go to our next home with you. Today we remember Carl, and we celebrate this son of God, this child of God, who has been yours his whole life long. And today we ask for your comfort and your peace and your resilience for those who love him best and for all those that he has touched in his long life and the stories that we each carry and the love that we continue to carry for him. We offer you now our words, praying together as you first taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And these are the words chosen by Carl's family to express his own connection to his Creator and to creation itself. Psalm 121. I lift my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you while you slumber, he does not slumber. And he watches over Israel, and he will never, never sleep nor slumber. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forevermore. So ends the reading. Please rise if you are able and join us for the first song, In the Garden. And I should say that this song is particularly chosen because I promised to play it on a recording. We're going to hear it on that organ.
Remembrance, and on behalf of our family, we're very thankful and grateful. This see so many friends come to honor each other. It's certainly not possible in a few moments to summarize your justice to the rich white elk that my father led. However, when I reflected after he died to think about what defined his life, there are certainly some principles that were core to who he was as a man. He had a great love for sport and the outdoors. This was instilled in him in his childhood, growing up in a family of three boys. He developed a love of skiing and golf at a very early age, which stayed with him throughout his life. I'm not sure there was anyone who had as much fun on a pair of skis as he did. His father, John, was an avid outdoorsman and brought up his sons, in particular Carl, to appreciate hunting and fishing. My father talked quite fondly of fox hunting with his father in Massachusetts and Essex, partridge hunting in Carlisle in the west of Boston. They spent their summers as a family on Lake Winnipesaukee at Northwoods Camp, where my grandfather was a director and my grandmother lived in the farmhouse. My dad was quite an accomplished athlete. He was very humble in manner, but never wanted to draw attention to his accomplishments. At Boston University, he was on the varsity in both golf and skiing. And he was captain of both teams, and his accomplishments, trophies, and awards in downhill skiing in New England over those 4 years are really remarkable. He was a true patriot and put himself through college with the help of an ROTC scholarship. And after graduation, he was commissioned as a second lieutenant in the U.S. Army. He spoke very often and quite fondly of his 2 years in the Army at Fort Leonard Wood in Missouri. And I think he must have had a pretty good gig there for a couple of years, as most of his stories really had not much to do with soldiering. He was much more involved in playing golf with one of the other Army characters. He incorporated his love of sport into his profession. He had the ambition and great fortune to purchase the Tennessee Squash Shop in Harvard Square in 1967. He spent the next 30 years of his life working 6 days a week to make that retail business a success. And my father never tired and never complained. The Tennessee Squash Shop, as many of you know, was much more than a business to my father. He himself became part of the first fabric that was the Harvard Square community. He was friends to so many at Tennessee Squash, both rich, famous, and everyday man. And he treated everyone with kindness, dignity, fairness, and respect. It was much more than a business. So many friends and family members, in times of hardship or need, were given a job by my father at Tennessee Squash. And if they were really in need in their life, they moved into our home for a period until they get back on their feet. It was also through the Tennessee Squash Shop that my father developed a lifelong friendship with the Dick Weber. I know my dad looked back fondly on his friendship with Dick with great fondness, as it led to becoming a member of Jones Pond Camp in Jackson, Maine. There was simply no place on earth that brought my father more joy than spending time in Jones Pond. So many great trips there, almost always together with his closest friend, Carl Lundgren, hunting deer in November, catching trout in the spring and summer. Jones Pond was a very special place to my father. He had a lifelong love of music, and as many of you know, played the accordion for his life. The accordion for my father was part of his being. It was music for social gatherings at home for him. He played with his family and friends gathered. He played when he was a member of the Massachusetts Ski Club here in the North Country. He played at Jones Pond and at Stone Hut. So many pictures and memories of my father and his accordion surrounded by family or friends with a great smile on his face. My father was a great family man. He was raised in a strong, close family. And he was a guiding principle throughout his life. He lived by example and was a loving father. There's probably no greater testament to the person he was than the faith and commitment to which he lived his life. That is nearly 58 years of faithful and loving marriage to his wife, Judy. It was a simple thing in life that brought my father great joy. He loved to simply run his chainsaw or cut wood. reputation helping others, meeting strangers, making friends. He was a very generous and kind soul. Finally, my father was very spiritual. He was brought up in a family of strong Christian values. He was a volunteer at our church in Stowe, where I grew up, holding the office of treasurer for many years. He told me a few years ago that he still prayed every day. Usually a prayer that he learned as a boy, which he in turn taught to his grandson when they were young. And I'd like to share it with you, as I feel it's very symbolic of the simple principles by which you live your life. Heavenly Father, give me clean hands, clean words, and clean thoughts. Help me to stand for the hard way against the easy road. Keep me from habits to harm. Teach me to work hard, and play is fair, and thy sight alone, as if the whole world saw. Forgive me when I am unkind, and help me to forgive my others when I am unkind to them. Keep ready to help others at some cost to myself, and send me chances to do a little good every day, and so grow more like Christ. Amen.
Scott captures so much about Carl. Is Darren here? Darren, would you come forward, please?
Thank you for taking so long to get up here. I've been in the victim of this so much. It's a pleasure to talk. Let's talk.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
It's a break, I'm slow. Anyway, as I say, I first met Carl 20 years or so ago in the Adventist teaching. And we had lockers, adjacent lockers, so it was kind of natural to be a funny little person like him. I didn't know at the time that he came out of BU and was on the speaking, but I used to admire how well he could speak. He's eloquent in what his little speech, and he picked him out of a crowd that he was coming down the trail. And so we had a lot of good time staying together. Carl was a humble guy and very understated. And the reason I pick on skiing as a quality or a time frame of his life, I'll tell you this story, which will identify or shed light on the homeless. My wife and I, Lynn, we'd go out skiing to a steamboat. Sometimes we'd go out for 2 months because we didn't know something to do. So, a steamboat has a guy up there by the name of Billy Kidd. I'm sure many people on this budget know that name. He's their kind of figurehead of skiing. He's a very important person there. Figurehead, very important, most famous, I think, for having, he was the first American male skier to win a medal in skiing. I think he won silver in the 64 Olympics. So he was clearly a skilled skater. Well, I'm telling Carl about this because I'm telling him about Steamboat. He hears the name Billy Jigs often, okay, in my talk, okay, he says, hang on. So he goes out, he goes in the other room, he comes back, and brings out a copy of the Conway Irregular, which is a newspaper here, I think here before the Conway Sun. And he shows it to me, it's a header, cut out of the paper. And there's an article about the Harvey Gibson Cup, which was a race they had back here in North Carolina for this particular year. This is probably in the late 50s, I'm guessing. So I'm reading it, and then there's the standings. And the first four or five names were big names here, for sure. And like number five is Carl Ford. Like, wow. Then about number seven or eight is Billy Kidd. I didn't have to tell him. I figured it out on my own. The other thing, again, is experiences I had with Carl that taught me about what he was and who he was and how he was. Was a fisherman. We were both fly fishermen. For those of you who fly fish, you know that it's not a natural thing. You have to learn it. There's a lot. It's a difficult thing to do. It doesn't come natural, as opposed to fishing with worms. Anybody catch fish with worms. So we fished all over the Israel River. I mentioned skill levels. You can always tell which of us was Carl. He was the one with all the fish. Fishing was part of the Jones Pond experience. And for those, and I was fortunate enough to have gone up there several times. It is like stepping back into a different world. Probably built in the early 1900s, okay, classic, rustic place. Carl was in his element here. I mean, he liked this place. We'd get there, it was the first weekend it was open, typically Memorial Day, get to the winter. And he'd be out there fixing things and putting this stuff together. All these little things that were telling him, you know. But it was a lifestyle that he enjoyed, you know, getting up and cooking breakfast. You go out fishing before breakfast, after lunch, before dinner. And then you wind up out on the porch. I learned that Carl liked his bourbon early times. I didn't even know what early times was. Okay, but sit on the porch and watch the sunset, okay, and just enjoy a little bit of the lunch. So it was an incredible experience. So what did I learn from that? I learned from that he was a hardworking guy. He jumped in, he got things done. He didn't ask necessarily for help, but he was just a can-do and will-do kind of guy. So with that, I think I'll end here because Judy's told me I don't have much time. I think we can make a phone call. But let me just say, Carl was, he was a really unique guy. Okay, and as I thought about it, I said, how would I describe him? Well, a couple ways. One, I'd say he was a good friend. He was a gentleman. True gentleman. Okay. I don't think I ever heard him use a two-letter word. Well, that's amazing. Particularly being a golfer. So anyway, that was my experience. I didn't know him all that long, like a lot of folks here in the audience, okay, but I was impressed. He was a unique person. Thank you.
Before I ask Virgil to come forward, I just want to ask, are there any other people that wish to stand and say something among all of us here this morning? Would you like to come forward?
I'm Greg Premer. Scott and I grew up here in high school, and that's how I got to know Carl.
I was one of the lucky ones that he stupid and clear his way. He was a mentor. Like a second father to me. Taught me how to fly fish. Brought me to Jones Pond, where I just came from this morning. It's still beautiful. And he was a free gentleman. And he did kissed my father's friend. You know, I should speak earlier. She said, he was not just my friend's father. He became a dear friend of mine. And it's something I think that happens not only when we ski together, but when we spend 2 or 3 hours in the canoe together, just fishing.
Thank you, Greg. Are there any friends who wish to say anything before we call her for the board? Yes, please come.
Thank you. Judy, Terry, thank you. I spent a lot of time with Carl, so I feel somewhat qualified in spending a long time. I'll try to keep it short. And I told Jean that if it gets too long, all she has to do is this, and I'll get the picture that she next to stage right. But I not only spent time with Carl in winter and summer, I also spent time with Carl in the spring and fall also. Carl was a true four-season sportsman. There's no question about it. Carl was an individual of extreme high character. We all know that. We've had testimony through that day, and everybody knows that. I observed that, and I'm sure a lot of us here did. Carl, I've never heard him in the time I've known him, and that's been over nearly 25 years. I've never heard him say anything bad about anyone, never heard him use harsh language, get upset. He was always very, very calm. That was true on the golf course, true, as Dan had mentioned. So it's very, very good in that respect. Gene and I first met Carl and Judy. It was at the, with Kevin Donovan and Maggie Driscoll over at Cranmore and becoming ambassadors. And this was at a ski area ambassadors. This is people that greet people when they come in the ski area and so forth like that. And just don't get paid, but you get a free season pass. We always like to try to get the free season pass. So we successfully did that. And that was other people that did that also. It was, of course, Bill and Carol Deming, I see in the crowd here. Gordon and Barbara Wood, I see also. We were all in that group to be ambassadors. And we did that for a number of years. I remember Judy and Carl also were very instrumental in initiating the initial Harness Night ski race. you will remember that, she was very key in getting the food. The food used to not be bought. It used to be donated by Judy and others working very hard and going all over the valley to the various restaurants and getting food items. Carl and myself, but Carl more than me, would have to go out and pick up all these food items from the various restaurants, and it was all over town. We were in the Cranbourne when to host the Honest Night ski race. Carl and I were on the same ski team for a number of years, and that was also a very nice activity. About 1998, Carl and I decided that we would go be ski instructors, but we didn't want to be at Lonely Cranbourne. We wanted to go to the big time Attitash. So we went over to Attitash and saw the ski meister there. And he went out with us to test us to see if we could ski. We managed to get down a hill without falling, so we were instantly qualified. We were watched over by the likes of Joe Webb, of course. He watched us very closely, not sure we make too many mistakes. But Carl dearly loved being a ski instructor. He taught hundreds of people how to ski at Attitash. This was over a period of about approximately 10 years. I skied with Carl many times, and at times when we didn't have any customers, we would go out and ski together, along with Dan. We skied the whole mountain. I'm not kidding you, everywhere we skied over that mountain, Bear Peak, and in Main Attitash, and in between, over the bridge, in between, we skied the whole area. Not a single time in all of that time did I ever see Carl Fuller fall down on the snow. Not a single time. He was that good. He was the best skier. Roy, I'm sorry, I have to pass the wand. Carl was as smooth as he possibly could be. Every time he skied, no matter what the conditions, it looked like he was skiing in whipped cream. He was able to handle skis that were so small as they were. I only saw Carl one time on the snow, Judy, and you'll probably remember that. We were teaching classes at that so-called beginner slope at Bear Peak for beginners, which was too steep for that. But he was in front of his class, and along came a skier, I can't remember if it was a male or a female, down the slope, out of control, not knowing how to ski. Carl was in front of his group, and she wiped him out completely down the slope. I don't know if he broke ribs or broke a wrist. I don't remember, Judy, but he was out for a couple of weeks, a week or a couple of weeks out at that time. That's the only time I think I ever saw him on snow. Another thing Carl loved to do in skiing, and Dan will remember it well, was the British troops that we come over. Joe Webb remembers these well. That's when a couple of hundred British kids would come to Attitash. They would divide them up into groups of 10 or 12 skiers, and we would have each ski instructor would have a group of skiers, and these were teenagers. They were 10th, 11th, and 12th grade equivalent from Scotland or England or Wales or Wales. And we would have them from Monday through Friday for approximately 6 hours a day. And when we got them first, they knew nothing about skiing. If you ask them, well, have you learned to ski? You know how to ski. We learned on dry slope. Whoa, that's not going to do the trick. Sure enough, they didn't know much about skiing. So we'd teach them for a week and send them away. Then you work Saturday, Sunday, then you'd have another week of another British troop. And that was a time of all hands on deck in the ski area to help out with the British kids. Carl was so good on Friday afternoon when we bid adieu to the various ski groups. Carl was always so kind to his group. They respected him so much for his ability and his way to handle the group that his group always did very, very good in learning to ski. And I'm sure a lot of adults now over in England or the British Isles will remember Carl as the initial ski instructor that taught him about them how to ski. As I said, Carl was a four-season person. You never saw Carl without that ubiquitous truck that he had. He always had his truck no matter where he went in groups. In springtime, he had one thing, as Dan mentioned, that is trout fishing. I spent commission and tried to explain all the flies to me that were in the bug system I had.
I never would have called on.
Carl kept going up fishing to these various places that he probably took Dan to, but some of them were very secret. I said, Carl, I'd like to go to some of your places that you go trout fishing when I go sometimes. He said, oh, no, it can't, it's a secret. I said, I won't tell anybody. He said, if I tell you, it won't be a secret. I said, Scout Honor, I'll keep it a secret. So indeed, as Dan, he took me up to some places on the Amadusi, up around the old Crawford House, up in Crawford Notch, and there's just favorite places. But that was a very, very fun time for me, and I learned a lot about trout fishing from Carl. Of course, we all remember Carl was a golfer. He loved to play golf. I think the best thing Carl liked about golf was the fact that we sat down over at Madeline's after, and we had a nice time talking over the various things that happened that day, who won, who didn't have a good day. But Carl loved the time he spent with all the golf guys. He really did love it. He also loved transitioning over to the turtle group that came along while we were there. We started playing golf with Carl long before the Turtles showed up. I'm talking about long before Kevin Walker came as ski instructor, before Ed LaPierre became ski instructor, way back when in the early 90s we started playing golf over at Jackson with Carl. So we played a long time, but Carl was enjoyed going over to the Turtles after he really did the book. The group we were playing with that we had before the Turtles showed up, we started off about 15 guys, but attrition was bringing the group down. We were missing guys. And one of the last ones we lost was Carl's very, very dear friend, Leonardo Di Benedetto. Lenny was Carl's one of his best friends, and Carl just loved Lenny, and we loved playing golf with Lenny. You go cut wood with Carl, you always had to go cut wood a little bit with Lenny, and Carl always loved doing things to other people. So that was summertime. Well, what did fall bring with Carl in the sports activity? He continued his trout fishing, but there was always wood cutting. And I wanted to get into having my little going, so I said, Carl, I'd like to learn how to use the chainsaw. He said, well, come over and I'll show you. So we went over, he had this area right next to his garage, Junior, where they remember. It was well used. That's where Carl cut all his wood. The only thing that lacked between a commercial operation and just his home use was the license to be a commercial operator. He definitely lived there. So he said, okay, you brought your chainsaw, that's very good. You bought the chainsaw, very good. Let's start cutting wood. So I start cutting, and he says, no, don't cut that away. I said, why? He said, it'll kick back on you, and you'll have a tiger by the tail that has teeth as sharp as razors, and it will slice through your hand or your leg like a knife through butter. I said, oh, that makes sense. That's a good idea. Showed me some other points, and thanks to Carl, so we cut a lot of wood. And after you cut the wood, comes, as somebody else mentioned, his sound like a freight train wood splitter. So I said, oh, that's nice. That butter is good. But I asked, maybe I can learn to do this. So I just put them with lots of wood and splitting them up. Let me give it a try. No, don't put your hand that way. Little loose fingers. It will slice through your finger like what you heard before. I said, oh, good, Carl. So after all the wood that I've split, after all these years of chainsaw activity, I still got it. Thank you, Carl, and I appreciate that. So Carl was truly a very, very good friend. I enjoyed every time I spent with him. They are very high moral characteristics, very high character, and was an individual anyone would want to be a friend of, and I certainly enjoyed the time that I spent with Carl Jr.
I think you can hear from the many stories that have been shared by Carl Spence Scott, by his his friends, Dan and Virgil, and by those who stood up and shared also Greg. And say your name. Some of the stories that I've told you have already been told. Chainsaws, and wood chippers, and trout fishing, skiing, and golfing. These are the stories that his family shares. These are the stories that he told me himself when he was at home, looking out his window, sitting with his beloved Judy. Was there anything that Carl ever touched that he didn't do well? What he chose to pick up and do, he did with passion, and with commitment, and with balance. He lived his life with a centeredness, faith, ethics, passion at the heart of what he did. When he was on the team at college, he was the best of the best and a leader. And he continued to follow those passions for golf and skiing into his young adulthood. Indeed, thanks to skiing, that's how he met Judy. They met when she came out from her ski club and walked into a room, and he was up here from his ski club. And what he said to me was that when he saw her, the stars fell out of the sky. So maybe he wasn't a man of too many words, but he had the right ones when he needed them. And he followed those passions. We know he played the accordion. He learned how to play it. He couldn't read music, but he could play by ear. He played for everyone's enjoyment. From the people that he was out skiing with, to the neighborhood children that Scott and Terry grew up with down in Massachusetts, who came over and knocked on the door and asked not that Mr. Fuller would play, but if Carl would play, because he told the children, "Don't call me Mr. Fuller, that's my father." Everyone knew him. Everyone that got to know him knew Carl. And not always by word, but so much by deed. Apparently, the ride up to Stowe, Vermont, always included enough space to pick up a vagabond. There was always somebody, as Scott said, who needed a ride, a meal, a place to stay, a job, a sense of purpose, a way of being connected. And Carl had a sensibility about that. He could make friends wherever he went. As the saying goes, strangers are only friends we haven't met yet. And Carl had an knack for meeting them, and then finding them again at places like airports and making his family wait while he chatted with them and said hello again. The balance that he showed came in many forms. He would go camping because he loved to be out in the woods, but camp wasn't deep enough into the woods. He had to leave the camp, right? And go further afield into those secret places where he would be alone with his fishing. And then come back to the joy of his family. And as much as he loved golf and however accomplished he was at one point or another, it started to require so much time that he began to trade his passion for golf for other passions, such as camping and fishing, that gave him time with his family. He chose people first. Terry would say that as much as he loved the racing, his passion wasn't so much about the racing as it was about the teaching and the mentoring. You heard that. He loved the camaraderie of being with the other people that could teach those to ski who didn't know how to ski. He loved to watch somebody learn to enjoy something that he already knew so deeply. And he had the patience to meet people where they were and start with what they loved and knew and share something new with them. did it with Cal and Nico. I bet you each spent time with your grandfather, and one way or another he shared with you his passion for fly fishing. I hear that Cal learned the intricacies of tying a fly. Is that right? And Nico went out and learned the art of casting the rod and reel. He knew that people learn differently and connect differently with their passion, and he met people where they were. And he brought them to the places that he loved the best. And he chose first the people that he worked with, the people that he played with and studied with, the people that he taught, and the family that he built with Judy. His heart is in his relationships, above everything else. And his heart was in the creation that he loved and introduced so many people to. He was a man who showed you for his passion and his love, not with his words, but by the time that he gave you, the way that he used his music to help people at the Merriman House, the seat that he saved at a table for a stranger, the way he showed up with the wood chipper, the spirit, the many ways that he gave people connection, gave of his time and his gifts and himself. You each carry stories within you that are all about Carl. And today what we remember is that we are connected to a great story, a story that begins with a love that changes everything, and a love that flows down through the centuries, people of faith sharing their stories again and again and again. Carl was taught by his father, and so he taught his son and his daughter and his grandson, and those that he adopted and loved so well. And each of us, we are part of Carl's story. He is part of our story. And this is a story of love and passion that goes on. Today we invite you to tell each other your stories about Carl. And if you haven't, please write them down in the memory book to remember him fondly, and to go on living with the same kind of passion and balance that Carl shared with all of us. Thanks be to God. And right now, Alan's just going to play a couple of the tunes that Carl used to play on the accordion, and because we have compressed the ways that people get to say goodbye to Carl, this is a time when we would actually invite you to come forward and just maybe just say a word, if you're able to, one word that Carl brings to mind. And if you don't have a word, then offer your silence, but come forward and say hello and goodbye to Carl. And then afterwards, sorry. So please, come forward. Let's start over here, if you will. Guys, come forward. Stay word for
thank you.
offer fine for the insert in the bulletin. We'll just do two verses, and we're going to try to hear Carl's accordion somewhere in there. Children and saw their dignity and their value and took time to get to know them and help them be connected and feeling so connected to know your love in such a special, simple, genuine way. We give thanks for Carl, your son. And we ask also for peace, for healing, for gentleness, for those that are here, who have loved him and who miss him so much, to live into the stories that they carry about Carl, and the story that is Carl's and theirs together, ours together. We ask blessing on the stories in this room, the lives in this room, and the countless hundreds, even thousands of people who have met and known Carl and carry a piece of his story in their hearts and their lives and the ways that they live in the world because they met him. Bless each of us here and abroad that we may too be your sons and daughters who also meet others with the same tenderness and compassion and cheerfulness and patience that Carl gave to each of your sons and your daughters in his lifetime. Thanks be to God. And we offer this up as benediction. May the robe rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. May the snow fall soft upon your December fields. And may the deep peace of the Prince of Peace be with you body, mind, and spirit. Until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. Brothers and sisters, go in peace.